Genesis chapter 1 verse 31 says, "And God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good." God created this world, and all that he created in this world, he made beautiful. So God's word created what was good. Unfortunately, man thought that he knew more than God, and he negated God's word through his own word, his own stubbornness. He negated what God did. Yet, God did not hold it against human beings, but he used his own word to heal humankind. God's word heals. It has a soothing, healing effect, a restoring effect. You check that out in Genesis chapters 1 and 2. Friends, it is so beautiful that we are children of God, the God who heals. He heals not only our physical selves, but even our inner selves. And these entire sessions, which we will try and go through, we will try and see how the dirt and the grime of the world has affected us, in which areas it has affected us, and how we can get over it. Paul, in his letter to the Ephesians, chapter 3, verses 14 to 21, he speaks about something on those lines, but specifically in verse 16, he says, "I pray that out of his glorious riches, he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being." So Paul speaks about being strengthened in the Spirit in our inner being. You know, friends, the brain is like a huge, powerful computer. Everything that ever happens around us or to us is recorded in the brain. Now, let's say that you are listening to whatever I'm saying right now. You can also hear some sounds in the background. Maybe someone shouting in the background. Maybe a car going around. Something or the other. You are able to perceive what is going on around you despite you listening to me. Your brain is picking up all the stimulus which is there around you. That is the power of the brain. It picks up everything, whether good or bad. Much of it is recorded. It is stored in the brain. But some of it just goes off. Now, what each person's brain stores, what each person's brain throws out, it is left to our constitution, to our makeup. So, each one of us, we have experienced so many incidents and situations in our lives, and we have either responded badly, responded well. Some of us have been healed of negative experiences, but many of us in this world today, we are suffering the after effects of things which have happened to us, which have hurt us. It's simple. I always like to give this example of GIGO. It's like a computer language. G-I-G-O. Garbage in, garbage out. So I say, suppose I key in a computer. 2 + 2 = 9. I feed that information into the computer. 2 + 2 = 9. Every time you type into the computer 2 + 2, your answer will always be 9. Now, if you want to rectify that, you have to go back into the memory of the computer, amend that, 2 + 2 = 4. From now onwards, your answer, whenever you type out 2 + 2, your answer will be 4. So, what you feed into the computer will give you back. It's something similar in our lives, friends. What we have received, whatever we have received from our parents, from our circumstances, friends, relatives, neighbors, whatever it be, it shapes us to be what we are today. That's garbage in. If garbage has been fed inside, we live a life like garbage. If we've been fed good things, maybe we will be better people today. So, we base our entire session today on these few illustrations. The first thing is, like this entire session, or let me say these sessions comprise of four parts, okay? So the first part will be the stages in my life that may need inner healing. The first stage is ancestry. Friends, it is very, very important to know that ancestry is not a superstition, nor is it that God has cursed my ancestry. It's nothing of that sort. Just ask yourself, or I will ask myself, when I was conceived in my mother's womb, it was not just two pieces of flesh that fused in to create or for me to be conceived. Yes, the sperm and the egg, they met together, but they were not just two pieces of flesh, but they also consisted of the spirit, the life of the father and the mother. So it is not only the physical attributes, but even the spiritual, the psychological and other attributes of the parents that will come down to the child. It is not only the parents, but if the parents had inherited some things from their parents, remember, it is a possibility that those attributes also have come down to the parents and have gone down to us. So ancestry is not just a random thing where we say, okay, this is wrong to you, it's because of your ancestry. There is a clear-cut pattern as to why we consider the ancestry of a person also sometimes, which is responsible for lack of inner healing, or for some certain distorted behavioral patterns which we have today. So our ancestry, it may be that our grandparents or great-grandparents, they were into some sort of addictions, maybe alcoholism, maybe some other addiction, maybe adulteress, maybe there were murders or something of that sort. It has come down through the ancestry. So it is not just something random. It has come down because that spiritual attribute has also come down through the ancestry. So we need healing first of all in the area of ancestry. Friends, don't ever feel that somebody, just because somebody is praying over you and they are trying to fool you into believing, just like that, at random, ancestry, there is a cause, there is a necessity. So maybe if my parents or my grandparents or someone, they were very moody, they were into depression. Maybe my great grandparents had depression. Grandparents did not, parents did not, but still that has come down. It has come down and we have inherited it. We need healing. The next area that we need, perhaps we need inner healing, is in the area of conception. It is a possibility that our conception, in the words of our parents or our neighbors, was out of fluke, out of rape, out of lust, out of force. But mostly people say it was out of fluke, it was unwanted. That area where I feel life doesn't make any sense. It is just out of fluke that I was born. Maybe that's an area that I need healing. So that's the next area. Conception. How was I conceived? Again, did that conception take place after marriage, before marriage? Then there are cases where we see where people were born within 3 or 4 months of getting married because they were conceived already well before getting married. And that is a sense of guilt, a sense of shame which the child goes through. Maybe till today you feel that shame, you feel that you are not balanced. Maybe we need to check out our conception. Under what circumstances I was conceived. Because I know again of people where once they were conceived in the mother's womb, that is before getting married, the father or the mother wanted to abort the child at conception, once they were conceived, because they were feeling ashamed. But then either because of spiritual reasons or others, otherwise, they were forced to keep their child. And subsequently, the child goes into depression and feels unwanted and goes into all sorts of negative psychological patterns. That area needs healing. It needs the Lord. People need the Lord. At the end of broken dreams, He is the open door. So, the area of conception. The next area that perhaps we need in a healing is the 9 months in our mother's womb. You know, friends, when the child is safely within the mother's womb, covered with the amniotic fluid, absolute darkness, it cannot see anything, it is just secure inside there in the mother's womb. What happens to that child? The only source of information is the mother. Because whatever the mother feels, the child feels. If the mother goes through distress, or maybe the mother is anxious, say the father is outside, he is not living with the mother, but has gone abroad for work, for employment or something, and the mother is always anxious, what's going on with the father, is he well, is this happening, is that happening, that anxiety is pushed onto the child feels that anxiety. Or maybe the father is a drunk, and he comes in and he hammers the mother feels that fear, the mother feels that that insecurity, the child absorbs it. And the child later on starts manifesting all sorts of unwanted destructive patterns. Or maybe when the child was in the mother's womb, there was not sufficient money at home. The financial situation was bad, and all the time the mother was anxious about money. Today the child will feel very greedy for money, because at that time, there was a lack of money, perhaps there was a lack of food, perhaps they did not have proper accommodation. So, basically, the time in the mother's womb, those 9 months, are a critical time for the child. Sometimes, perhaps the child was unwanted. The mother is feeling that it was like a curse for her to have the child. Why did I conceive this child? This child is the source of all trouble. Today the child will feel unwanted. Friends, but just remember a couple of things. Not all these stages pertain to all of us. When we come to the fourth part, maybe, we will discuss about how we need to locate which of these areas are in need of inner healing. So the 9 months in the mother's womb is another area which could need inner healing. Now for these areas, we need to check out with our parents, about our parents themselves and about our grandparents. What was our family history? Our ancestry? Under what circumstances was I conceived? How was the situation with my parents when I was in my mother's womb? Maybe we need to check out a little bit, and you will come to know a lot of things which perhaps will help you to be healed of, or even to locate why certain areas of your life are not in order. The next area is births. How was I born? Was it a natural birth? Or was it a cesarean? There are a lot of scientific studies which have come to the conclusion that a child who is born out of maybe a cesarean operation is more clinical, is very intelligent, is very, very highly intelligent, but is more clinical than a person who's born out of a normal birth. There again, birth, the time of birth, the parents don't know whether it's a boy or a girl. So the moment the child is born, it's a vital part of the child's later upbringing and growth, because the moment the child comes out of the mother's womb, it is suddenly exposed to lights, to people, to all sorts of new stimulus. It doesn't know what's happening. So we feel that maybe the child doesn't know anything, but remember, friends, the moment the child is conceived in the mother's womb, it is already a full human being. Whether we believe it or not, whether the vast majority of people believe it or not, the moment the child is conceived, it already knows, it is already able to perceive. So let us not fool ourselves into believing that, okay, for the first 3 months, it is just a fetus. There is nothing such as a fetus. It's a human being. So it is at birth. When the child comes into the world, a remark, oh, we got a girl. I wish we would have had a boy. Maybe the statement was made by the grandparents or the uncles or the aunties or the parents themselves. They express dissatisfaction. Why is this child born? The time of birth, instead of it being a happy time, turns out to be a very negative experience for the child. Again, if the child had a lot of struggle while being born, it will affect the child later on. Perhaps, how was the child born? Did the mother have a lot of trauma, insecurity while giving birth to the child, pain, not sure whether the child will live or not? Perhaps those feelings would have gone down into the child. So we need to check out how or what were the circumstances of my birth. The next stage where perhaps I would need inner healing is infancy. When we are born, suddenly we are out of the security of our mother's womb and we are into this world. Out, suddenly. And then we need the hugs. That's why, you know, even when I speak about birth, today in a lot of hospitals and in a lot of developed countries, immediately they take the child and put it on the mother's breast to give it support. And, you know, even in the traditional societies, they say that the child has to be wrapped around with a tight cloth when it is born, after it is born, for the first few days, because it was all the time in the mother's womb. No? It was secure there. Now suddenly it is insecure. So it is good that it is wrapped around. So the same thing happens with infancy. The first 4 years of the child. Now the child is left out and needs to pick up what the world is teaching it. Science has said that more than 75% of the brain is already formed during these first 4 to 5 years of the child's life. So whatever the child learns during those first 4 to 5 years will form the child's entire character for life. You teach a child languages during the first 4 or 5 years, they will pick it up like this. Try and teach people languages later on in life, it's much more difficult. You teach the child anything, the child will pick it up fast, because that's the time the brain grows the fastest. So whatever the child picks up during that period of time will be ingrained in that child's mind and the child's psyche. So if that child is seeing violence at home, if the child is finding that the father and the mother are always at loggerheads, if the child finds that there is distress and disharmony at home, It is going to affect the child. It is picking up all this in the infant, in the infancy stage. It is picking up all that is happening rapidly. That is why it is also said, the way the parents speak to the child, whatever the parents are doing, whatever you are exposing your child to, whether it is TV programs, whether it is the way you are speaking to each other arrogantly, whether you are speaking bad words, whether you are doing something which is very intimate, which a child should not be seeing at that point of time in front of the child, remember, you feel that the child is not watching you, but the child is watching everything that is happening. That's why sometimes, you know, when we are talking to a little infant, we say, oh, see that person here, see that child, see that baba, see that baby. They're talking like a big grandfather or like a big grandmother, small little child. Yeah, the child has picked up something from somewhere. Much of it, of course, may also be inspiration. The child must be intelligent, but a lot of this, the child is picking up either from the parents or from somewhere or the other. So we need to check out our own infancy. How was our infancy? Was it distressed? Was it disturbing? Was it abusive? So many children, the only way they learn is by being given a good pasting. They don't learn that way. They will be frightened children. Father coming home in a very aggressive manner, or division in the family, constant fights between in-laws and the parents, insecurity at home. Friends, the child will pick this up the first 4 to 5 years of life. So inner healing may be needed during my infancy. The next area where perhaps the next stage, I will say, it's not an area, the next stage which could need inner healing could be my early childhood and school. Again, I go back to birth. After I was born, once I am out into the world, I am insecure. Suddenly, I am out of the comfort of my mother's womb. Early childhood. Suddenly, I am out of the comfort of my house. From now onwards, I will be sent to school. I am leaving the comfort and the security of my house, of my home. No more will I be under the maybe protective cover of my parents. Now I will go to school. So there is suddenly a feeling of, I don't know what's going to happen to me. My parents are not there. Some children, till they are very old in life, they remember those first few days in school where they had to leave their parents and go to school. It was such a traumatic experience for them leaving home. But then that early childhood, once they reach school, again, what was the type of society they were exposed to in school? What type of friends they had? What type of teachers they had? Early childhood is another important area or another important stage in my life that could be in need of inner healing. Maybe the teacher was very strict. The love which I received from my parents at home, I was not getting from the teachers. Maybe they were comparing me with somebody else, my previous siblings or with other children. Maybe they were constantly criticizing me. Maybe they were always demoralizing me. Maybe the type of children which were there around me were not of a good moral character. And I learnt many things which were not good. So that early childhood of mine, which I spent in school, is another area which, or another stage which could need inner healing, because that is also the time where I learn values other than from my own home. At home, my parents teach me, my aunts, uncles, siblings, close neighbors teach me. Here, It's a different setup altogether. It's the school atmosphere, it is new games, it is new books, it is new subjects. I learn something brand new. What was the type of childhood, early childhood that I was exposed to once I was in school? Then there are times where a child is very timid. So other children take advantage of their child. They will rob their pencil, rob their rubber or eraser, pinch them, beat them. And you know, when the child goes home, the parents say only one thing: you must be responsible for it. And they are after the, they chastise the child without trying to find out. Or sometimes the child must be full of mischief, and the parents, they support the child. I see that in many, many circumstances. Instead of correcting the child, the parents arrogantly go and start, confronting the teachers and others in authority. They don't want to correct the child. Friends, we need to find out whether we've become arrogant because of this sort of circumstances which we had. So early childhood is something which I need to check out. Perhaps it is one of the causes why I have a problem today with the way I behave. The next stage, which could be in need of inner healing, is adolescence. It's a vital time of my life where my full body changes. My outlook on life changes. From being a child, now I am a child man or child woman. No more will I be thinking like a child. Now I grow physically as well as in my mind. Often, children learn intimate things not from their parents and not from their teachers, but from their friends in the wrong way. And so what happens? Not only they learn from their friends, but they learn it from social media. So what happens with this social media thing? They are watching a program, and the parents also are watching the program, which is full of a lot of immorality. So since the parents are watching something like that, it will happen that the child takes it as an approval, that the parents approve of my social behavior. That is, it is immoral, but the parents say it's okay. So maybe I pick up the knowledge of intimate things from me, from my friends, instead of learning what is good. I learn about my body, I learn about my sexuality from my friends, and they teach me what is bad. Perhaps I suffer abuse during that point, that period of time, boys as well as girls, sexual abuse. And today society is full of such stories. Very often we find girls, the first time they have had their menses, people start laughing at them and making fun of them. And for them, it becomes a very traumatic experience. We need to check out, perhaps, is my adolescent time, has it been a good time or a bad time? Pimples start coming up. So many things. People misunderstand me because that's the time also where I begin to rebel against my parents and all that, my teachers, and people misunderstand me. Instead of understanding that I'm changing, they start acting aggressive with me. I need to check that out. And the last stage, friends, is my youth or my present state of life. I join work, I get a job, perhaps I go into college and I get a job, I get married. What type of a marriage did I have? Was I accepted by my in-laws? My youth, did I have good friends? Did I get a good job? Was my job very strenuous? Was it full of stress? Was it something which I did not want? Did I get into college because I wanted that particular stream, or did my parents force me to take something which I did not want? Was I forced into something? Even the job, it was just because I was not getting anything else. Whatever was remaining, I took. Until today, I'm feeling very dissatisfied. My marriage, I wish I would have got married to someone else. This is not the person I wanted. Standard excuses today for divorce. I need to check out my present state of life. So friends, these are roughly stages in my life that would be in need of inner healing. Let us pray to the Lord that He would enlighten us. He would go back in time with us and help us to bring these areas to Him. For He says that whatever is in the darkness should be brought into the light. And it has to be brought into the light, to the light of the world, to Jesus, who's the mighty healer, the faithful God. God bless you, friends.